So let's talk about race. Ugh. Who wants to talk about that? There's a conversation that almost all of us want to avoid, precisely because it's difficult. And it's ridden with so many emotions, including sadness, grief, guilt, anxiety, anger, hopelessness. It's all there.
At last year's convention, in the wake of Bishop Eugene Sutton's address on racial justice and reparations, a resolution was passed directing the creation of a diocesan commission on racial justice and reparation to explore the history of racial injustice in our diocese and to formulate meaningful responses. The pandemic intervened and delayed this work, but it has not stopped it. Earlier this year, a group of clergy began meeting via Zoom to read and discuss books related to anti-racism work. We have formed a work group in hopes of carrying this effort forward in partnership with lay people.
Why am I doing this work? Bishop Sutton's talk last year at Diocesan Convention brought home to me the truth that the dignity afforded me as a white man is at the expense of the dignity of my brothers and sisters of color. I don't want something that's not rightfully mine. I don't want to live my life at another's expense. I want to work for the dignity of every human being, loving my neighbor as myself.
Why do I do this work? Well, as a Christian, I pray each day that God's kingdom may come on earth, and I envision a world where justice and peace prevail, and where the dignity of every human being is respected, and I work to make that vision a reality. As an American, I pledge allegiance to a country conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal, a nation united in its commitment to liberty and justice for all. That vision has not yet been realized, and our task is not to make America great, but to make America, America. How can we not do this work?
I do this work to explore my own blindness and to give me courage in an environment that is often more blind than I. I want to understand how we use white supremacy to create meaning and peace and how that connects to our beliefs about God. Some of my most significant relationships, including my spouse, have been with people of color. When I was younger, I argued that race didn't matter, that we shouldn't see it. I was wrong. I could not then acknowledge the differences that I now know I need to see. I began to understand the intersectionality, the ways aspects of persons' identity, such as gender, race, sexuality, religion, disability, can combine to create different kinds of discrimination and privilege. I am angry, frustrated, and challenged by this work. I also know and admit that as a white person, I can often leave this at the bottom of my to-do list. This work is hard, which is why we must do it.
I'm doing this work because 2.5 decades of life lived in the Deep South has embedded racism deep within me. Because every single day, an unexpected implicit bias arises within me, offering the reminder that no matter my commitment to living as an anti-racist, I've been conditioned by white supremacy. I'm doing this work because it's my responsibility to do so for the rest of my life.
The fact that I'm a white man in our society means I have a choice to engage in the work of racial justice or not. That alone is the definition of privilege. Jesus tells me to love my neighbor, but I also look around and realize most of the neighbors I interact with, socially, culturally, in our church, look like me. That's not a true vision of God's loving creation. That's why I commit to this work of repentance and racial justice.
A few years ago, it dawned on me that white privilege didn't just mean white male privilege. That as a white woman, I have privilege that my black sisters and brothers do not have. Recently, a black friend asked me if I worry about my young adult children. I said, yes, of course. I worry about their happiness or about them getting sick or being in an accident. But, she said, you don't worry about them because of the color of their skin. That broke my heart. No parent should have to worry about their children simply because of the color of their skin. That is why I'm doing this work.
I'm doing this work for two reasons. For my friends and parishioners, so that I can better understand the reality of my Black friends, converse with some credence, and better use my white privilege to bring about positive change. For myself, so that I can become a more authentic human, which means no longer living at the convenient surface layer of, yeah, I know this is a thing out there, but it's out there. Ignorance is easy and shallow, but I no longer want to live as an ignorant or shallow person.
I am doing this work because, as a member of the body of Christ, I am called to restore all people to unity with God and each other in Christ. More specifically, I am called to promote justice, peace, and love. To do this work, I cannot remain ignorant of and apathetic to how white privilege and white supremacy undermine the dignity of people of color.
I am called to this work because I have discovered that all of my good intentions are not enough. My declarations that I'm not a racist are not enough. I see our brothers and sisters of color hurting and suffering in ways that I will never have to. And when I don't speak up and when I ignore their experiences and cries for justice, then I am contributing to it. Psalm 51 calls us to a broken and contrite heart. A broken and contrite heart isn't the solution, but it's a first step toward the healing that comes from repentance and moves us closer toward wholeness for all of God's beloved children. On behalf of our working group, we invite everyone, laity and clergy, to participate in this work through your prayers, study, and action. We will be praying a litany of repentance as part of the liturgy at Diocesan Convention. The link to that litany is on the screen. And we'll be providing study resources to help us all move forward. The list of these resources will be published on the Diocesan website as they are assembled. And together, we will plan meaningful actions that will begin to make our communities and our churches places where everyone belongs and everyone has a place at the table, actions that move us forward toward our goal of racial justice and reparations. We hope that you'll join us on this journey toward realizing God's vision for our church, our society, and all humankind.